Today, we're delving into the intriguing life of a remarkable figure from biblical history, John the Baptist. John was a special man who lived a long time ago. He was a cousin of Jesus and played a vital role in preparing the way for Jesus' ministry. John's parents were an older couple named Zacharias and Elizabeth, the cousin of Mary. His parents raised him in the ways of the Lord, instilling in him a deep and unwavering faith from an early age. As John grew, he displayed a natural inclination for solitude and contemplation. His heart was drawn to the wilderness, and as a young man, he withdrew from the bustling life of the city to find solace in the rugged, unforgiving terrain of the desert. There, he lived a simple and ascetic life, clad in coarse clothing and sustaining himself with locusts and wild honey. They were some of his favorite food. In the depths of the desert, John's relationship with God deepened. The desert offered no distractions, only silence and the whispers of the wind. It was in this solitude that John felt the divine calling to become a voice in the wilderness. He went to the town and started speaking to the public about God and the coming of his messenger. His message attracted a following, and people from all walks of life flocked to hear his words and receive his baptism. John would stand by the river and tell people to be good and kind and to turn to God because the kingdom of God was coming soon.
Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
What must we do to repent?
Share your food and clothing with those in need. Be content with what you have.
He was like a good coach for our hearts. Even when important religious leaders came to see him, John didn't back down. He told them that everyone, no matter who they were, needed to be better and listen to God. One day, Jesus arrived from Galilee to be baptized by John. When Jesus asked John to baptize him, John tried to deter him, saying,
I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me? Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness.
As soon as Jesus was baptized, the Holy Spirit came down like a dove, and John knew that Jesus was God's Son. It was a very special moment for him. This was a time when the land was ruled by King Herod Antipas. King Herod's personal life was a mess. Herod had married Herodias, a woman of intense beauty and ambition. She had left her husband, Herod's brother Philip, to become Herod's wife, causing public scandal. This marriage was, in the eyes of many, both illegal and immoral. John had rebuked King Herod for divorcing his wife more than once. He was not afraid of anyone. Herodias seethed with anger toward John the Baptist because he dared to speak out. Herodias was a woman driven by her own twisted desires, sought revenge, and asked the king to arrest John.
But he is a good man.
Herodias resented John's influence over her husband and was determined to silence him.
He is becoming a problem. His message is gaining momentum. I fear it might lead to unrest.
Herod, perhaps slightly threatened by John's following, had him arrested and brought to his palace. In the grandeur of Herod's palace, John stood before Herod, unafraid. He looked directly into Herod's eyes and declared,
"Your marriage to Herodias is unlawful. You live in sin."
Herod hesitated, torn between his fascination for John and his loyalty to Herodias.
"Are you saying I should divorce her?"
"Yes, it is the only path to righteousness."
John did not shrink from his mission. Instead, he boldly declared the truth. Herod, though troubled by John's words, felt a strange fascination with this prophet. Herodias wanted John put to death, but could not do so on her own. Herod knew John to be a righteous man, so instead of killing him, John was ordered imprisoned. Herod's fear and curiosity drove him to visit John regularly in prison to hear him preach to other prisoners. Herod's wife, however, awaited a strategic opportunity, and the turning point soon arrived. One evening, Herod decided to host a grand birthday banquet, inviting the high-ranking officials, his military commanders, and the leading citizens of Galilee. The palace was adorned with extravagance, music, and feasting. The wine flowed freely, and the festivities were in full swing. Amidst the revelry, Herodias' stepdaughter Salome danced with grace and allure, capturing the attention of the inebriated guests. Her performance done, Herod and the guests applauded. Inflamed by his senses and the mood of the moment, Herod cried,
"Ask me what you want, up to half my kingdom, and it is yours."
And he swore a great oath to confirm his promise. Salome was under her mother's influence, so she approached her.
"What shall I ask for, dear mother?"
Down in the dungeons of Herod's fortress, a man's fate was about to be decided.
"Ask for John the Baptist's head on a platter."
Salome approached Herod. Evidently, she had made up her mind. The guests and the king turned to hear what she would ask.
"I desire the head of John the Baptist on a platter."
Herod, paled when he heard the words, regretted his promise. Looking around at his guests, he saw only one thing. If he was to save face, he must fulfill his promise.
"Very well. It shall be done."
Trapped between his oath and his reputation, King Herod reluctantly ordered the execution of the Baptist. In the dark chambers of the palace, Herodias and Salome shared a sinister embrace. Herodias whispered,
"You have secured our vengeance."
Salome, her eyes devoid of remorse, replied,
"He will trouble us no more."
News of John's execution spread, and Herod's conscience weighed heavily on him. He muttered to his advisors,
"I fear that John's spirit will haunt me for this."
"Perhaps it's a sign, sire, that we should mend our ways."
In the wilderness, John's disciples continued to preach his message.
"Our teacher gave his life for the truth. Let us carry his message forward."
The crowd nodded in agreement, inspired by John's unwavering commitment. Herod's life took a tumultuous turn. His reign was marked by external threats and internal strife. His marriage to Herodias did not bring the happiness and stability he had sought. As the years passed, his relationship with the Roman Empire deteriorated, and he was eventually exiled to Gaul by Emperor Caligula, marking the end of his rule.